Audible Studios presents Get Rich with Dividends, a proven system for earning double-digit returns. Written by Marc Lichtenfeld. Performed by Paul McClain.
Visual aids found in the print edition of this book are available to you as a downloadable PDF. To access this file, please click the link on the product page where you purchased this title. Thank you.
Foreword. When it comes to the stock market, most investors prefer glamour to profits. Why do I say this? Tell average investors about a company with a cutting-edge technology, an exciting phase 3 drug, or a new gold strike, and they are all ears. But tell them about a blue-chip stock with steady sales, a big order backlog, and a rising dividend yield, and they are more likely to stifle a yawn. That's unfortunate, because contrary to what most investors believe, startling innovation is not a good predictor of business success. Or, as the famous industrialist and steel magnate Andrew Carnegie succinctly put it, pioneering don't pay. A young company that is just feeling its oats and retaining all its earnings is unlikely to be the best long-term investment. It's a widely recognized fact that 80% of new businesses fail in the first 5 years. What really makes money for investors over time, and without the hair-raising volatility of hypergrowth stocks, is steady businesses paying regular dividends. For example, over the past decade, with dividends reinvested, oil producer Chevron Corp. has returned 200%. Altria Group, the U.S. tobacco giant, has returned more than 300%. Even musty old Con Edison, originally founded as New York Gas Light Company, a utility that was born 23 years before Thomas Edison, has returned 130% over the period. In this excellent new book, my friend, colleague, and fellow analyst, Marc Lichtenfeld, shows you how and why to invest in great dividend stocks. And let me make two things clear at the outset. Number one, you could not find a more worthy, knowledgeable, or trustworthy guide to the investment landscape. And second, this investment approach really works. How can I be sure? Marc runs the Oxford Club's Perpetual Income Portfolio, a portfolio based solely on growth and income investments. He has done a superb job. In fact, when I looked at the returns recently, I had to ask him, "Holy crap, Marc, how do you do it?" Fortunately, Marc shows you how you can earn returns like this yourself. He has made me a believer. At investment seminars today, I tell attendees, if you are looking for growth, invest in dividend stocks. If you are looking for income, invest in dividend stocks. If you are looking for safety, invest in dividend stocks. Why? Earnings may be suspicious due to creative accounting. Revenues can be booked in 1 year or several years. Capital assets can be sold and the value listed as ordinary income, but cash paid into your account is a sure thing, a litmus test of a company's true earnings. It's tangible evidence of a firm's profitability. Regular payouts impose fiscal discipline on a company, and history reveals that dividend-paying stocks are both less risky and more profitable than most stocks. Dr. Jeremy Siegel, a professor of finance at the Wharton School of the University of Pennsylvania, has done a thorough historical investigation of the performance of various asset classes over the last 200 years, including all types of stocks, bonds, cash, and precious metals. His conclusion? High dividend payers have outperformed the market by a wide margin over the long haul. There is an awful lot of fear and anxiety about the economy and the stock market today. Investors are understandably confused and uncertain about what to do with their money. Marc Lichtenfeld has your solution. He demonstrates that even during market declines, dividend-paying stocks hold up better than non-dividend-paying stocks and often fight the broad trend and rise in value. The reason is obvious. These tend to be mature, profitable companies with stable outlooks, plenty of cash, and long-term staying power. Bear in mind that U.S. companies are sitting on a record amount of cash right now, more than $2 trillion. Companies are not hiring, and they're not boosting spending, so a lot of this cash is rightfully going back to shareholders. The Dow currently yields more than bonds, and dividend growth among U.S. companies has averaged 10% per year over the last 2 years, more than double the long-term dividend growth rate. The current outlook is especially promising. Over the last 50 years, for instance, the highest 20% yielding stocks in the Standard & Poor's 500 returned 14.2% annually. That's good enough to double your money every 5 years, or quadruple it in 10. And if you were even more selective, say, investing only in the 10 highest yielding stocks of the 100 largest companies in the S&P 500, your annual return would have been even better, 15.7%. I should add the standard caveat here about past performance and point out that there are risks with dividend stocks too. As Mark points out, an investor would be foolish to plunk down money for a stock just because the dividend is large. You have to be selective. The market is full of dividend traps. Troubled companies that pay hefty dividends to keep investors from bailing out. In the pages that follow, you'll learn how to avoid those and zero in on potential winners. Mark shows you how to look at cash flow and payout ratios and whether the dividend is sustainable. Does this require a bit of legwork? Yes, but the payoff is large. It astonishes me that investors are willing to lend money to the U.S. Treasury for the next 10 years at less than 2%. What a terrible bet. One that virtually guarantees a negative, real after-inflation return over the next decade. A far better bet is a diversified portfolio of dividend-paying stocks. Over the 8 decades through 2010, dividends contributed 44% of the U.S. stock market's return, according to Fidelity Investments. Sometimes it was much more. During the 1970s, for example, dividends generated 71% of returns. Mark makes a strong case that dividend stocks today represent a historic opportunity. Not only are U.S. companies flush with cash, but payouts are less than one-third of profits, a historic low. Dividends alone won't generate a mouth-watering return. But they will rise over time, and surprising things happen when you reinvest them. Picture a snowball rolling downhill. Albert Einstein understood this, as he observed, "Money compounding is the most powerful force in the universe." And the best way to compound your money? Great companies that pay steady, rising dividends. This book is your key because Marc Lichtenfeld does a great job of showing you just where to find them. Alexander Green. Preface. It was a eureka moment. I was working on a dividend spreadsheet, changing the variables, when the size of the numbers I saw surprised me. I realized that if my kids' money was invested according to the formula I was working with, they should never have any financial problems in adulthood, no matter what job or career they choose. I also recognized that using the same formula, my wife and I should never have to worry about income in retirement. And last, I understood that if my parents invested according to the formula, they, too, should have no worries about income in old age. That's when I knew I had to write this book. Get Rich with Dividends is for the average investor, the investor who is just getting started, and the investor who is playing catch-up, the investor who has been burned by the booms and busts of the recent past, and the investor who trusted the wrong advisor and ended up paying thousands of dollars for worthless advice. This book is for all investors who are serious about creating real wealth for themselves and their families. Investors who are willing to learn a simple system for making their money work as hard as they do, or did. It's easy to learn and implement and takes very little free time. Importantly, it's not a theory. It's been proved to work over decades of bull and bear markets. And it's designed for investors who have other things they'd rather do than spend hours on their portfolios. Implement the 10-11-12 system and let stocks and time work their magic. All that's required is the occasional check-in from you to make sure the companies in your portfolio are still behaving the way you expect them to. If they are, and you'll learn how to pick companies that are most likely to meet your expectations, no further action is necessary. As the editor of the Oxford Club's Oxford Income Letter, I receive emails every month from investors who are yearning for higher yield. In this low-rate environment, current yields aren't cutting it for many retirees. I was inspired to find a strategy that would ensure investors will not be in the same boat in the future as today's income seekers who are taking on too much risk by chasing yield. The 10-11-12 system, outlined in Get Rich with Dividends, will enable investors to achieve yields of at least 11%, and possibly much more, in the next 10 years, all while investing in some of the most conservative stocks in the market. These are companies with track records, some decades long, of taking care of shareholders. And if you don't need the income today, 12% average annual total returns, which crush the stock market average, are easily attainable. Earning 12% per year more than triples your money in 10 years, quintuples in 15 years, and grows by well over 10 times in 20 years. In other words, earning an average of 12% per year for 20 years turns a $100,000 portfolio into nearly $1.4 million. And that's with no additional investments. What would an extra $1.4 million mean to you in retirement? First of all, it might spin off enough income that you wouldn't need to touch the principal. The money could be used for vacations with your family, a grandchild's college education, or peace of mind that you'll always have the best medical care. Perhaps most important, you'll learn how my 10-11-12 system can still enable you to earn significant yields and double-digit returns in flat or down markets. Despite the nastiest bear market, you'll be sleeping comfortably, even smiling once you implement my 10-11-12 system. As you make your way through this book, you'll learn everything you need to know to become a successful investor. It's easy to read and even easier to get started. In chapters 1 and 2, we go over why dividend stocks are the best kind of investment you can make for the long-term health of your portfolio. Since you don't want to invest in just any old company paying a dividend, we discuss the special kind of stocks that you should select and how to find them. I don't expect you to simply take my word for the claims I'm making. So, in Chapter 3, I show you how I arrived at the various numbers, taking you through examples of how your income and total return can grow every quarter, with an example of how the 10-11-12 system still works and even thrives in bear markets. In Chapter 4, we look at the big picture and the reason companies pay dividends. You'll understand why it's an important factor in determining the health of a business. You'll see why certain conservative stocks are your best bet in Chapter 5. There's no reason to take excess risk to achieve your goals when some of the most conservative stocks on the market will achieve better results. Chapter 6 discusses some interesting types of stocks you may not be aware of. Stocks that typically yield more than regular dividend payers. In Chapter 7, we lay the foundation for your portfolio, and then Chapter 8 is where you'll learn all about the 10-11-12 formula that you'll use to set you and your family up for long-term double-digit yields and returns. In Chapters 9, 10, and 11, we go over dividend reinvestment plans, DRIPs, foreign stocks, and options, all ways to turbocharge your returns. Chapter 12 discusses everyone's favorite subject, taxes. Even if you use a CPA to do your taxes for you, be sure to read Chapter 12 as there is important information that could make your investments much more tax efficient. And we wrap it all up in the conclusion and set you on your way to a lifetime of market-crushing returns and nights of worry-free, at least about your portfolio, sleep. The strongest endorsement of the 10-11-12 system that I can make is this. I'm using it for my investments and for my kids' money as well. Writing this book has been a labor of love, because I know there will be thousands of families who will achieve financial freedom, be able to send a kid to college, make a down payment on a house, and enjoy retirement as a result of following the 10-11-12 system. I'm glad yours will be one of them. Chapter 1. Why Dividend Stocks? Let me start by making a bold statement. The ideas in this book are one of the most important gifts you can give to yourself or your children. On the pages that follow is the recipe for generating 11% yields and 12% average annual returns for your portfolio, significantly more if the stock market or your particular stocks cooperate. I'm not trying to brag. I wasn't the one who first came up with the idea of investing in dividend growth stocks. I just repackaged it in a compelling, easy-to-read book that you will cherish for a lifetime and want to buy more copies of for all your friends and family, or at least lend them yours. Enough jokes, for now. What I did was create an easy-to-learn system for investing in dividend growth stocks. You'll not only understand why dividend growth investing is one of the most lucrative and uncomplicated ways to invest, but also learn the simple steps of how to do it. If you follow the ideas in this book and teach them to your children, it's very conceivable that many of your concerns about income in the future will be over. And perhaps just as important, if your children learn this strategy at a young age, they may never have financial difficulties. They will have the tools to set themselves up for income and wealth far before they are ready to retire. Keep in mind that I cannot teach you or your children how to save money. If you would rather buy a new car at the expense of putting money away, I can't and won't attempt to fix that. This book is for the people who already know how to save and are trying to make that money work as hard as they do. As far as saving money is concerned, the only advice I'll offer can be found in one of my favorite finance books, The Richest Man in Babylon by George S. Clason. In that book, first published in 1926, Clason writes, "For every 10 coins thou placest in thy purse, take out for use but 9. Thy purse will start to fatten at once, and its increasing weight will feel good in thy hand and bring satisfaction to thy soul." Many personal finance gurus proclaim the same advice, but with a more modern bent to it, stating, "Pay yourself first." Even if you are not able to save 10% of your current income, saving anything is crucial. As you will see, the money you save and invest using the ideas in this book will grow significantly over the years. So, if you can save only 8%, or 5%, or even 2%, start doing it now. And if you get a raise or an inheritance or win the football pool, do not spend a dime of it until you have put away 10% of your total income. Here's a scary statistic. According to a 2013 survey by the Employee Benefit Research Institute and Matthew Greenwald and Associates, 57% of American workers had less than $25,000 saved for retirement, with half of those people reporting less than $1,000 saved. See Table 1.1. And in 2013, the average 65-year-old's 401k account had just $25,000 in it. If you are serious about improving your family's financial future, and I know you are because you're investing the time to read this book, start saving today, if you haven't already. Imagine if you save 10% of your money and put it into the kinds of dividend stocks discussed in this book. Over time, your wealth should grow to the point that it will have generated significant amounts of income, perhaps even replacing the need to work. This is the last point I will make about saving. You didn't spend your money on this book or drive all the way to the library just to have me beat you up about saving. Instead, I will assume you really are serious about securing your future and want to learn how to take those funds and add a few zeros to the end of the total number in your portfolio. And if you're already retired and you need income right away, the strategies in this book can help you too. You may not have the ability to compound your wealth, but you can invest in companies that will generate more and more income for you every year. Not only can you beat inflation, but you can also give yourself, and even your loved ones, an extra cushion. There are lots of ways to invest your hard-earned money, but you'll soon see why investing in dividend stocks is a conservative way to generate significant amounts of wealth and income. This isn't theory. It's been proved over decades of market history. Some people believe that real estate is the only way to riches. Others say the stock market is rigged so that the only people who make money are the professionals. Therefore, you should be in the safety of bonds. Still, others trust only precious metals. None of these beliefs is true at all. Within the stock market, there are various strategies that are valid. Value investors insist you should buy stocks when they're cheap and sell when they're expensive. Growth investors believe you should own stocks whose earnings are growing at a rapid clip. Momentum investors suggest throwing valuation out the window and investing in stocks that are moving higher and getting out when they stop climbing. Still, others trust only stock charts. They couldn't care less what a company's earnings, cash flow, or margins are. As long as it looks good on the chart, it's a buy. Each of these methodologies works at some point. The effectiveness of value and growth strategies tend to alternate. One will be in favor while the other is out until they trade places. For one stretch of time, value stocks outperform. Then, for another few years, growth will be stronger. Eventually, value will be back in fashion. Whichever is in vogue at the moment, supporters of each will come up with all kinds of statistics that prove their method is the only way to go. The same dynamic applies when it comes to fundamentals versus technicals. The technical analysts, who read stock charts, assert that everything you need to know about a company is reflected in its price and revealed in the charts. Fundamental analysts, who study the company's financial statements, maintain that technical analysis is akin to throwing chicken bones and reading tea leaves. There are plenty of other methodologies as well. These include quantitative investing, cycle analysis, and growth at a reasonable price, GARP, to name just a few more. Die-hard supporters of all these strategies claim that their way is the only way to make money in the markets. It's almost like a religion whose most fanatical followers act as if their beliefs are the only truth, period, no debate, end of story. They're right and you're wrong if you don't believe the same thing they do. I'm no authority when it comes to theology, but when it comes to investing, I know this: dogma does not work. You will not consistently make money investing only in value stocks. Again, sometimes they're out of favor. If you only read stock charts, sometimes you'll be wrong. Charts are not crystal balls. Quantitative investing tends to work until it doesn't. Just ask the investors in long-term capital management, which lost everything in 1998. Long-term capital was a $4.7 billion hedge fund that utilized complex mathematical models to construct trades. It made a lot of money for investors for several years. It was supposed to be fail-safe, like the Titanic, which was also supposed to be unsinkable, long-term capital hit an iceberg in the form of the Russian financial crisis, and nearly all was lost. Y'all must have forgot. During his prime, legendary boxer Roy Jones Jr. was one of the best fighters that many fans had ever seen. However, Jones didn't seem to get as much respect as he thought he deserved, so, in 2001, he released a rap song that listed his accomplishments and reminded fans about just how good he was. The song was titled, Y'all Must Have Forgot. Roy was a much better fighter than he was a rapper. The song was horrendous. Looking back, investors in the mid to late 1990s remind me of boxing fans in 2001, when Roy released his epic tribute to himself. Both groups seemed to have forgotten how good they had it. Boxing fans no longer appreciated the immense skills of Jones, and investors grew tired and impatient with the 10.9% average annual returns of the Standard & Poor's S&P 500, including dividends, since 1961. After decades of investing sensibly in companies that were good businesses that often returned money to shareholders in the form of dividends, many investors became speculators, swept up in the dot-com mania. I'm not blaming anyone or wagging my finger. I was right there with him during the high-flying dot-com days. I was trading in and out of internet stocks too. My first 10-bagger, a stock that goes up 10 times the original investment, was Polycom, NASDAQ PLCM. I bought it at $4 and sold some at $50. I sold up and down along the way. However, like many dot-com speculators, I got caught holding the bag once or twice as well. I probably still have my Kawaka stock certificate somewhere in my files. Never heard of Kawaka? Exactly. The company went bankrupt in 2002. With stocks going up 10, 20, 30 points or more a day, it was hard not to get swept up in hysteria. And who wanted to think about stocks that paid 4% dividends when you could make 4% in about 5 minutes in shares of Oracle, NASDAQ ORCL, or Ariba, NASDAQ ARBA? Did it really make sense to invest in Johnson & Johnson, New York Stock Exchange, JNJ? At that time, rather than eToys? After all, eToys was going to be the next category killer, according to Bank Boston, Robertson Stevens in 1999. It's interesting to note that eToys was out of business 18 months later, and Bank Boston, Robertson Stevens, went under about a year after that. If, in late 1998, you'd invested in Johnson & Johnson, a boring stock with a dividend yield of about 1.7% at that time, and reinvested the dividends, in mid-2014, you'd have made about 8.6% per year on your money. A $3,000 investment would have nearly quadrupled. Johnson & Johnson is a real business, with real products and revenue. It's not as exciting as eToys or Pets.com or any of the hot business-to-business B2B.coms that took the market by storm. But 16 years later, are there any investors who would complain about an 8.6 annual return per year? I doubt there are very many, especially when you consider that the S&P 500's annual return, including reinvested dividends, was just 4.2% during the same period. Now, you might have gotten lucky and bought eBay, NASDAQ EBAY, at $2 per share and made 16 times your money. Or maybe you bought Oracle and made 5 times your money. But for every eBay and Oracle that became big, successful businesses, there were several web vans that failed and whose stocks went to zero. In the late 1990s, the stock market became a casino where many investors lost a ton of money and didn't even get a free ticket for the buffet. It doesn't seem that we've ever completely returned to the old way of looking at things. My grandfather, a certified public accountant who owned a seat on the New York Stock Exchange, didn't invest in the market looking to make a quick buck. He put money away for the long term, expecting the investment to generate a greater return than he would have been able to achieve elsewhere, and possibly some income. He was willing to take risk, but not to the point where he was speculating on companies with such ludicrous business ideas that the only way to make money would be to find someone more foolish than he to buy his shares. This is an actual and badly flawed theory used by some. Not surprisingly, it's called the greater fool theory. There were all kinds of companies. Theglobe.com, Netcentives, and Kawaka, to name just a few, whose CEOs declared, "We were in a new era. This time was different." When I asked them about revenue, they told me it was all about eyeballs. When I pressed them about profits, they told me I didn't understand the new paradigm. Maybe I didn't, and still don't. But I know that a business has to eventually have revenue and profits. At least a successful one does. I'm 100% certain that if Grandpa had been an active investor in those days, he wouldn't have gone anywhere near theglobe.com. One principle that I believe many investors have forgotten is that they are investing in a business. Whether that business is a retail store, a steel company, or a semiconductor equipment manufacturer, these are businesses run by managers with employees, customers, and equipment. And one hopes, profits. They're not just 3 or 4-letter ticker symbols that you enter into Yahoo Finance once in a while to check on the stock price. And these real businesses can create a significant amount of wealth for shareholders, particularly if the dividend is reinvested. According to Ed Clissold of Ned Davis Research, if you'd invested $100 in the S&P 500 at the end of 1929, it would have grown to $4,989 in 2010, based on the price appreciation alone. However, if you'd reinvested the dividends, your $100 would have grown to $117,774. Clissold says that 95.8% of the return came from dividends. See figure 1.1. Marc Lichtenfeld's Authentic Italian Trattoria. Years ago, my wife and I were in Ashland, Oregon. We loved the town and started talking about escaping the rat race, moving to Ashland, and opening a pizza place. We repeated that conversation on trips to Banff in the Canadian Rockies, Asheville, North Carolina, and even Tel Aviv, Israel. Considering that I know nothing about the restaurant business, would not be happy if not in close vicinity to a major American city, and am a lousy cook, the pizza joint remained a happy fantasy. But for the purpose of this book, Marc Lichtenfeld's Authentic Italian Trattoria will serve as an example of a business with revenue and profits. We're also going to assume that I'm your brother-in-law. Your sister was always a very good judge of character, and you've agreed to become my partner in the business. One day, I come to you, my favorite brother-sister-in-law, with my plans for the restaurant. I have the space lined up. It's in a popular location with a lot of foot traffic. I've been talking with a wonderful young chef who is eager to make an impression on local diners and critics. All that's missing is startup capital. This is where you come in. In exchange for a $100,000 investment, you will receive a 10% ownership stake. I show you my projections. The restaurant will break even the first year and make $100,000 in the second year and $200,000 in the third year. One of the questions you may have is, how will you get your money back? Do you have to wait for the restaurant to be sold, or will you receive some of the profit each year? If I tell you that my goal is to build the business to $1.5 million in sales and then sell it for 2x sales, $3 million, Where you'll receive $300,000, your response might be very different from what it would be if I tell you that half the profits will be invested back in the business, with the other half split up among the partners in a yearly payout, dividend. Your decision on whether to give me the money will depend in part on your goals. Are you willing to speculate that you'll receive the big payoff in several years when the business is sold? Or would you rather receive an income stream from your investment but no exit strategy, plan to sell the restaurant? When buying stocks, investors have to make similar decisions. Do they buy a stock with the sole purpose of selling it higher down the road? Or do they buy one that provides an income stream and opportunities for income growth in addition to capital gains? I don't know about you, but if I'm investing in someone's business, I want to see some money as soon as possible rather than wait for an exit strategy. Here's another factor that might affect your decision to invest in my trattoria. Instead of offering to pay you your cut of the profits every year, I might offer to reinvest that money back into the restaurant and give you more equity. That way, your piece of the profits gets larger each year. Eventually, you can start collecting a significant cash payout annually, or receive a bigger slice of the pie when you sell your stake in the business because your equity has increased above your original 10%. This last scenario is the same as reinvesting dividends, a method that is the surest way I know of to create wealth. And what I love about this strategy is that it works and has worked, no matter who is president of the United States, what happens in Europe, Iran, or the Middle East, how high unemployment and inflation are, and so on. Sure, those things will affect your short-term results, but over the long haul, they mean nothing, and in fact, could help you accumulate more wealth, as I'll explain in the section on bear markets in Chapter 3. The numbers. Investing in dividend stocks is the best way to make money in the stock market over the long term. But don't just take my word for it. Harvey Rubin and Carlos Spatt, the second, both of Louisiana State University in Shreveport, write, "For those investors who adopt 10 and 15-year time horizons, the dividend investment strategy will lead to financial independence for life, regardless of the direction of the market. A constant and growing dividend is a never-ending income stream." Just a few pages ago, I told you that dogma doesn't work. Yet here, I am sounding fairly dogmatic. The proof that dividend investing creates wealth is in the numbers. First of all, investing in the stock market works. Since 1937, if you invested in the broad market index, you made money in 69 out of 76 rolling 10-year periods for a 91% win rate. That includes reinvesting dividends. The seven 10-year periods that were losers ended in 1937, 1938, 1939, 1940, 1946, 2008, and 2009. The periods 1937 to 1940 and 1946 were tied to the Great Depression. The 10-year periods ending 1936 to 1940 were brutal, with an average decline of 40%. The decade ending in 1946 was much tamer, with a loss of 11%. The 2008 and 2009 10-year periods each lost 9%. Paul Asquith and David W. Mullins, Jr. of Harvard University concluded that stocks that initiated a dividend and increased their dividends produced excess returns for shareholders. Additionally, the larger the first dividend payment and subsequent dividend raises, the larger the outperformance. And research shows that dividend stocks significantly outperform during market downturns. Kathleen P. Fuller and Michael A. Goldstein of Babson College concluded dividend-paying stocks outperform non-dividend-paying stocks by 1 to 2% more per month in declining markets than in advancing markets, In recessions, the outperformance is even more pronounced. During the recessions of 2001 and 2008, the Dividend Aristocrat Index, more on aristocrats in the next chapter, outperformed the S&P 500 by 6.45 percentage points annually, according to Albert Williams and Mitchell Miller of Nova Southeastern University. Later on in the book, I'll show you how you can achieve double-digit yields, which would nullify the effects of even the weakest historical market's performance, and enable you to make money regardless of what the overall market is doing. Think back to other methods that I mentioned at the beginning of the chapter: value, growth, and technical analysis. They all work, sometimes. No system, strategy, or methodology that I know of has a 91% win rate that can approach 100% when the dividends have been reinvested for a while. Oh, I know, but it's different this time. We're in an unprecedented period of debt, unemployment, financial crisis, and everything else unpleasant under the sun. Things were pretty lousy in 2009. With the entire financial system on the precipice of collapse. Nevertheless, the market came roaring back, doubling in 2 years and tripling in five. Similarly, there was little to get excited about during the 1970s, with mortgages and inflation in the teens and each U.S. president less popular than the last. Yet, the 10-year return on the market was positive every year throughout the 1970s and 1980s, encompassing years from the 1970s. Since 1937, the average cumulative rolling 10-year total return on the stock market is 128%. This includes the seven negative 10-year periods. Since 1999, the first year the 10-year data was available, the S&P Dividend Aristocrat Index's 10-year rolling return average has been 183% and was positive every year, with the lowest 10-year return of 40% in the period ending in 2008, when the market tanked 38% that year. Compared with a 9% loss for the S&P 500 in the 10 years ending in 2008, and a loss of 26% when you exclude dividends. I recently read a government official's estimate, and we know how accurate government officials usually are, that over the next 10 years, stocks will lose 13% because of baby boomers taking their money out of the market. I don't think that's likely. As I've shown you, historically, there's a 91% chance of the market giving you a positive return over 10 years. Additionally, where are the baby boomers going to put their money? Bonds are paying ridiculously low interest rates right now. Is it worth it to lock up your funds for 10 years to earn 2.5%? That won't even keep up with inflation. For that little, I'd rather invest in a stock with a 4% or 5% yield and take the risk that in 10 years, the stock will at least be where I bought it today. But you know what? Even if the stock falls, you can still make money. Let's assume you buy 500 shares of stock at $20 for a total of $10,000. It pays a dividend of $1 per year or a yield of 5%. Now, this company has a long history of raising its dividend every year. Over the next 10 years, it raises the dividend by an average of 5% per year. Let's also assume that the government official was right, and the stock tracks the market and falls 13%. If you reinvest your dividends for the next 10 years while the dividend is increasing and the stock price is falling, you'll wind up with about $17,000. That's a 70% increase, or a compounded annual growth rate of 5.45%, despite a decline in stock price of 13%. But what if you invested in a 10-year treasury paying 2.5% per year? After 10 years, you would get your $10,000 back, plus collect $2,500 in interest for a total of $12,500, or a compounded annual growth rate of 2.26%. So in this example, your stock investment lost 13% in price, yet still more than doubled the performance.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.